Thank you very much, please. May I add to my colleagues, the gentlemen of the press? It seems like the camera is empty, please. Let's find the place to sit, please. Please, we don't want you to stand in front of our special guests, particularly our young fathers. On this note, ladies and gentlemen, may I give an audience to please stand for the Vice Chancellor, the French Park, and the Honorary Rector of the Police. All of us, shall we please stand? Thank you.
I would like to welcome all of us to the 334th inaugural lecture of this university. The inaugural lecture today will be delivered by Modupe Adeola Adelabu, a professor of educational administration in the Department of Educational Management of Bafemi Awolowo University, Ile-Ife. Professor Adelabu is a product of Christ School, Ado-Ekiti, Olivet Baptist High School, Oyo, and Obafemi Awolowo University, Ile-Ife. Her research interests revolve around policy, politics, and personnel issues in education. Professor Adelabu started her career as a graduate assistant in 1976 in the Department of Educational Administration and Planning, where she rose to the rank of professor in 2008. She has over 40 publications to her credit and has attended over 50 conferences across the world. She was head of the department from 2005 to 2011. She has also served as external examiner to several universities. Professor Adelabu has been a chief consultant to the National Primary Education Commission, NPEC, and the Universal Basic Education Commission, UBEC, for many years. She is a consultant to many regional and international development partners, such as the World Bank, UNESCO, UNICEF, DFID, and the International Labour Organization, among others. She has held council membership of many government and private institutions, among which are the National Teachers Institute, NTI, Joseph Ayobabalala University, JABU, and the Ekiti State World Bank Assisted Poverty Reduction Agency. She is a current member of the Oxford Roundtable, Oxford University, and Educational Task Force in the Ekiti State. Professor Adelabu, in the course of her career, has worked with many eminent scholars, politicians, and notable individuals, and some of those men and women of distinction are here with us today. I can mention Chief Adeyemo, the Deputy Governor of Oyo State, and Erelu, Dr. Mrs. Fayemi, the First Lady of Ekiti State. Professor Adelabu is a recipient of many international awards, including the Canadian International Development Agency, CIDA, CIDA, Mount St. Vincent University, Halifax, Canada, and the Kwame Nkrumah Leadership Award as African Administration Icon. Professor Adelabu is a former chairperson of the State Universal Basic Education Board and former deputy governor of Ekiti State. Currently, Professor Adelabu is the vice chairman, South, Nigeria's Presidential School Debate, and also Chairman, National Board of Technical Education, MBTE. I welcome Professor Modupe Adeola Adedabu to present the 334th inaugural lecture of this great institution, titled As It Was in the Beginning, So It Is Now, Politics and Education Policies in Nigeria. Thank you.
Determines its policies, distributes its advantages, and similar classic definitions of politics in rule that of Arnold Afton 1936. Who defined politics as who gets what, when, and how? And this thing started to clarify the important definition of politics as a qualitative allocation of values. Education, especially formal education, is a value which is often advocated by politics. In defining public policy cycle as tentative, the political process of policies are another name. A scholar of the politics of education as I am, we of necessity investigate the role of special factors and actors in the policy making process. This calls for studies related to the role of elected officials, the voting body, and the support institutions, along with those constitutionally enabled actors in the formulation and implementation of education policies. The students of the politics of education ought to investigate the role of the organizing society, such as labor unions, private providers of education, women and ethnic groups, churches and mosques, in the formulation and implementation of education policies. The politics of school administration and the activities of school administrators, as well as the spatial, social, and economic environment of education policies and practice, should also be investigated by students of the politics of education. To the extent that we live in a globalized world, we also ought to examine the effects of global standards and mandates on education policies in Nigeria. Sir, for more than 2 decades, I diligently conducted research in all the areas identified above. The interaction between politics and education. The politics of education refers to the process by which individual and group interests compete over and negotiate on the allocation of resources as well as the purpose, objectives, and goals of education. For more than 2.5 centuries ago, the Swiss pedagogue and educator Jean Pestalozzi, 1744 to 1827, identified education as an instrument of social reform through individual development. Education is therefore for him a public good that confers social, political, and economic benefits for both society and individuals. For the purpose of this lecture, the focus is mainly on formal education. Education is considered formal when its instructional processes are planned and graded by approved authorities and when definite infrastructure exists for its promotion. If education is understood in this way, the politics affecting it must be judged against the public interest, and such interest must be declared by public governments for contently representing the people's interests associated and associated with society entities. This is why it can be asserted that the functions of government include an appropriate policy of education relevant to political, social, and economic environments. Policies on education are affected to different degrees by domestic and international political, economic, historical, and social-cultural factors, including globalization. Adelabu 1990, Adelabu 2004, took a costly look at the global trends on how politics and interacted to shape the education policies of some ancient and modern societies. The study revealed that across the world, in Europe, Asia, Middle East, and in many other regions, education policies in different circles were shaped by not only the politics of the different societies, but by the abiding dominant philosophies of those societies. By way of illustration, the European philosophers of old recognized the centrality of education to the subsistence of the society. For instance, Plato, the Greek philosopher, in his Republic, argued that only a few people have the capacity to learn the art of governing through the development of the virtue required for leadership. And this development is the exclusive function of formal education. Similarly, Aristotle adopted in his Politics that to secure a global society, education of the young to the good life is necessary. Similarly, successive administrations to Britain have cultivated great interest in education with the aim of training and consolidating the governing class. The Tudors were quick to realize the importance of the kind of education that will make them more efficient. In the same way, it has become difficult to draw any clear distinction between education and politics and between education and ideology, especially since the successful Leninist Revolution of 1917. The Leninist Education Government Secretary provided that the teaching work in schools and the whole organization of school life should be directed towards promoting proletarian class consciousness in the mind of the pupils, thus preparing them for useful and productive political activity in the state. In January, philosophers such as Chatterton elaborated that the regeneration of the country is to be accomplished by the state. In the United States of America, education is seen as the foundation which makes the people to work. In China, one commonly accepted explanation for the changes in Chinese education is rooted in the connection between education policy and internal power struggle. Back home in Nigeria, the same symbiotic relationship between politics and education is primarily in the modern. Some are rooted in formal, informal, and non-formal educational system. For instance, the traditional educational system is funded where it involves circumstances in politics, the economy, and culture, again in 2004. It is pertinent to note that education was also used extensively as a political, cultural, and economic tool by various organized religions in Nigeria. In Islam, the promotion of Arabic language Quranic education provided not only literacy but also a common language of communication between Nigerians and the proselytizing North Africans, which in turn promoted trade and political linkages. With regard to Christianity, foreign education that came through the Christian missionaries could be described as an area of British imperialism in West Africa at around 1969. It is also obvious that early missionaries used their education policies to pave the way for the colonization of Nigeria. In seeking to consolidate British power in Nigeria, the colonial regime had to deal directly with educational matters, having seen it as a veritable tool for effective colonization. The badge viewed education as an instrument to be used explicitly for political ends. To him, education was the most important and most urgent of all policy choices to secure the amalgamation of Nigeria. Lugard's philosophy of secular education as a means of character training was later used as a means of indoctrination back then in 1976. When confirming the symbiotic relationship between education and politics, Thomas 1976 observed that whenever any country is going through political transformation, the leaders always engage in revamping the old educational system. This was the case in Nigeria, where the evolution of federalism provided the three regions in Nigeria the autonomy and opportunity to legislate on education policies that are consistent with the individual regional policies and tenets of the federal structure. When federalism was introduced in 1951 by the Mapasa Constitution, it provided the real opportunities for the old Western region of Nigeria to design and implement education policies that were distinctly different from those of the other two regions of the country, and that were responsive to the needs and the level of development of the region. This resulted in the first ever universal primary education, UPE, in Nigeria, and then after 1990, and then after 2017. Paradoxically, education was used by the colonial powers for domination, became the tool for emancipation in Nigeria. Many of the nationalists who championed Nigerian political emancipation by those who had the privilege of Western education. A couple of decades down the road, we find an exemplary evidence of the disarticulation between politics and education policies. The 1976 UPE policy, during the military regime, was primarily facilitated by the extant Nigerian political environment, having suspended the constitution and in consonance with the military regime's centralization policy. The government transferred primary education from compliant list to exclusive list. The policy was used to bring about the much needed rehabilitation of the eastern states that witnessed a heavy school dropout during the Civil War. Beyond this, the UP was led to bridge the educational gap and pervasive inequality between the North and South. A gap that was bound factors are not the only drivers of education policies. Economic circumstances and ambitions are significant determinants. As demonstrated in many of my publications, the buoyant economy of Western Nigeria in the 1950s, driven by cocoa production and exports, facilitated some positive achievements in the education structure. Furthermore, the 1950s food security policy was also facilitated by the petroleum oil boom of the 1970s. These instances bear witness to the fact that, more than any other factor, the nation's economy also determines the agenda and content of education policy. Education policy is a political participation. Political participation refers to the various ways citizens of any society engage in political process and seek to influence outcomes. It may be formal or informal. Formal participation tends to conform to constitutional and legal provisions, while informal participation tends to be exacerbated and outside the boundaries of the established political process. It may be channeled through state institutions or the civil society, such as labor and student unions, women and religious groups, and so on. Thus, understood. 14. Registering the political party, violent and non-violent protests, petitioning state of officials are all examples of political participation. Ajinabu 2008 showed a correlation between interest and political participation. In Fanny Rush and Act of 1971, the study differentiated the quality of participation of respondents who are rural religious. The quality of political participation ranges from mobile political office to merely showing interest in politics and voting as shown in Figure 1 in the note. The study by Ajinabu and Akin Solu 2009 shows that higher institutions and where ideologies are taught and better opportunities for political engagement are achieved. This confirms Almond and Palmer 1963 arguments that education determines political attitude and that the more intensive an individual education is, the greater the likelihood that he or she will be more aware of the relevance of government activities, further development of policies, how one political information, and engage in political discussion with a wider range of people. Mr. Vice Chancellor, as a proposition, while one cannot deny the correlation between literacy and political participation in Nigeria, this correlation is at best more nuanced and yet than direct. Many of scholars and students of Nigerian politics have correctly noted that politics is more vocal, aggressive, and prominent among the grassroots of society, the majority of who are non-literate. They tend to vote at a higher rate and behave politically more aggressive than the theory predicts. Thus, it can be argued that the Nigerian rural and non-literate electorates actively participate in politics, perhaps even more actively than the literate cohort of the electorate. However, as this is a separate theory, compared to the literate segment of the electorate, by the non-literate segment of the electorate is low. The question arises, why is this so? The answers have been turned into a better capture that work to provide the use of the non-literate segment of society. Also, the Constitution, which stipulates that the minimum qualification for any person seeking elective votes in Nigeria is 72 certificates, which automatically disqualifies the non-literate segment of the electorate from participating at a qualitatively higher level than their literate fellow citizens. Secondly, Nigerian electoral politics is money grossly. Almost by definition, the non-literate segment of the electorate and society is definitely poor and an attractive to the so-called political godfathers. Consequently, the poor and the non-literate are destined to become political fathers in the Nigerian political game. Therefore, to the extent that there is a strong correlation between literacy and quality of participation on one hand, poverty and national underdevelopment on the other, the status interest of the political class is protected by a denial of functional education of the non-literate segment of the society and the intolerable level of underdevelopment and poverty. Thus, The national interest is then decided by the promotion of universal functional and quality education in the country, the civil society. It is misleading to conclude that the influence of the stereotypical Nigerian masses on policy choices is low because of poor quality of participation in the formal political process. The quality of political participation is often measured by the location and the activities of the individual or group in the formally recognized political process system and structure. This is why many analysts of African politics claim that the overwhelming segment of the population do not participate in politics. However, in the past 2 decades or so, political alliances have taken a different look into the civil society and found that the political influence of Africans of the political process can best be measured by the activities in the civil society. It can be measured by how they activate their memberships in labor union and associations, civic organizations, ethnic commissions, religious organizations, and resistance movements to seize the attention of the state and extract favorable constitution and policies, or else challenge and contest policy decisions and outcomes. The community is a useful resource to the democratization of education. Towards this agenda of 2002, advocated a strategy for state community partnership for the universal basic education, UBE. This is grounded on the fact that the UBE scheme may not have met the expectation of both the government and stakeholders due to lack of support from them. It therefore became imperative to explore areas of cooperation between the communities and governments in the implementation of the program. This study analyzed the roles and responsibilities of the communities in the provision of basic education and in the implementation of UBE scheme in their areas. It revealed varying degrees of participation in different democratic areas. The school-based management committee, BMC, is another form of community participation in education. This was set up in 2011 with global effort to increase citizen participation in school management. It is another way of decentralizing school control, either from the federal, state, and local government to individual schools and communities. The study by Ogunleye and Adeola in 2009, and Adeola in 2009 again, focused on the health of the school child as a major factor in educational quality management as well. This is because quality learners and others who are healthy are supported in learning by their families and communities. Since their programs have found to reach more pupils through their families and communities than any other form of health education, the FPS presents an obvious value for reaching the parents, the community, and the students. The non-state providers, NSP, also known as private school proprietors, also play a significant role, not only in democratizing education, but in making it accessible. Towards this, most of the data in 2007, investigated the role of NSP in achieving education for all in Nigeria. Equal educational opportunities and equity in education may be difficult to achieve if the state, the community, and also state providers do not complement one another. Adelabu 1991, Adelabu 2000, Ogunleye and Adelabu 2009. The need for private support in education grew because sentiments suggest that while the overall net enrollment rate for Nigeria and the average in sub-Saharan Africa, just one third of those in the poorest quartile have been school. One important finding of the study of NSP was the establishment of registered private providers of education, referred to as Association of Community Educational Development, AFED, in Lagos State in 2002, in response to government threats to shut down their unregistered or illegal schools. AFED, although not recognized by Lagos State government, but because their schools were more pro grassroots and more pro indigent than all other private schools, AFED seemed to enjoy political popularity with the poor and grassroots who were the voters and who mobilized either support or work against government or any political party. Consequently, government often turned blind eyes to the unregistered schools. In any group, for instance, individual proprietors of an approved schools also have political interests which they have been able to exert to advance inclusion. This is a direct way of participation of both civil society and the community power structure in education policy intervention. And in 2002 noted that despite several attempts to democratize education in Nigeria since 1955, this attempt failed to fully universalize education in its effort to make education accessible to all sectors. The federal government established the National Commission for Mass Literacy, Adult and Non-Formal Education, which was charged with promoting literacy nationwide. It also advocated such programs as Each One Teach One, or Each One Taught the Teaching of One. Within the entire concept, a broader view therefore emerged, which emphasized the education of all, wherever, wherever, and however that it takes place. Based on this concept, I designed the model for positive democratization and universalization of education, as seen below. This model is hinged on my belief that education for all should not rest only on primary resources, which are teachers, but on any resource person who can facilitate learning, be it in a formal or non-formal way. The position of this study, therefore, is that just as there is universal right in education, there is also a corresponding duty for others to support the education of the non-literate among them. During the economic recession 1980s, Adelabu 1992, argued that policy making is affected by prevailing circumstances, which may cause a divergence between policy making and policy implementation. To be considered well formulated, education policies must be compatible with the political and economic projections, both of which are difficult to predict. To demonstrate how the economic fortune of a nation became the process of failure of ostensibly well formulated policies, Adelabu reviewed two historical cases: the worldwide shortage of raw materials after the Second World War, 1999-1945, resulted in phenomenal increase in the export trade of Nigeria, as shown in the table below. It was this unprecedented and unanticipated financial boom that facilitated the UPE of Western region in 1955, which was subsequently followed by Eastern and other regions. Just as the oil boom of the 1970s facilitated the federal government UPE of 1976. However, 2 decades down the road, the country now investing in that episodic economic booms were almost inadequate for the financing of sustainable free education policies. The study on education policy making and implementation in the era of economic recession, which are considered as far back as 1992, demonstrated this fact all too well. As it was then, so it is now. In the budget speech in 1978, the then Nigerian head of state, General Obasanjo, noted, and I quote, "All revenue is not a cure-all, and resources from oil are not enough to satisfy the Ghanaians' aspirations and the new needs of our people's development and social services." End of quote. The effort to match policy aspirations with available resources led to a lack of austerity measures, which eventually culminated in the structural adjustment program, SAP, in 1986. The nation's expenditure on education was drastically reduced. Teachers were retrenched, new ones were not recruited, and the ones on ground were not regularly paid. Non-salary items also suffered tremendously, while school infrastructure was in shambles. This poor funding of education led to a relative difference between government's wish and its achievements. In any period of economic recession, it is advisable for government to generate funds for education from non-traditional sources. After all, in the 1960s, agricultural development was very spectacular. Produce magnetic balls in the natural regions of Nigeria were set up to export our agricultural commodities. These produce magnetic balls were able to fund the establishment of universities in the three regions: Amadibelo University, Zaria, Northern Region, University of Nigeria, also Nigeria, the Osun-Adisa region, and the University of Ife, now Bakani Awolowo University, Western Region, only for 2010. For this reason, one could commend the federal government SM policy on diversification of the economy. Other than the political economy, there are other factors in the policy environment, such as cultural and fiscal environment, which also affect education policy making and implementation. One of such factors is rural and urban dichotomy in relation to education. Many of the migrated to urban areas for employment to enable them to get out of poverty, whereas even in the urban areas, the poor exists. The problem in rural education is not only with the content of the curriculum, but also with its relevance. The crucial problem, therefore, is how to combine the official curriculum with local content and also in the school with the community, so that we can work together to provide resources and application of the knowledge and skills students would have learned at the NAMI 2008. Unless the government and tournament pursue a concerted and sustained program of rural development, we can expect that rural urban migration will persist. This is based, as we argue, on the fact that the job aspirations of rural students derive from an understanding that formal education consists of academic courses only rather than vocational and technical courses. Adding up 1987 also considered unemployment as a major factor for the urban poor. The more education a person acquires, the greater is the range of job opportunities that will be available to him or her, and the greater he is on her security against unemployment and consequently against poverty. Based on the findings, Adinaku concluded that technical and vocational education can combat poverty in urban regions as well as in the rural areas. Traditional crafts and industries such as yarn spinning, dyeing, weaving, pottery making, basketball, and non processing that have disappeared in the rural areas should be integrated into vocational and technical education for the various communities. Globalization and education policies. Broadly defined, globalization embodies and explicit strengths and characteristics which tend to de-emphasize the primacy of the traditional nation states, whilst anonymously associated the ascendancy of worldwide structure, regimes, practices, and tendencies. Since a nation is not an island unto itself. It's about five years time. In my research, I found that globalization is an imperative for changes in education policy making and implementation in Nigeria, as it now goes for the world. Nigeria's education policies are influenced by both local and global political, economy, and technological trends. And in 2007, showed that globalization constitutes an inescapable imperative for changes in education policies. Nigeria made the first attempt to the first ever universal primary education scheme, where it declared that, I quote, survival as a race in this atomic age will depend on our ability to initiate and our competence to implement both things of political, economic, and educational advancement. This was said by Awokoya in Nigeria during the Nigeria Western debates in 1952, as quoted in Abel Abu 1990. Both the federal and universal UPE of both the federal and universal education scheme of 1976, the National Policy on Education, with this 334 structure, resulting in the UPE scheme and the general education for all exercise, show that Nigeria had consistently fashioned its educational policies to make a relevant to develop economies and consequently through education integrator into the global economy. Globalization also affects changes in school curriculum from monocultural approach to education to multicultural approach. Hence, the emphasis of technical education in the National Policy on Education 2003. Considering the intensity and intensity of globalization, I think that in 2014 underscored the need to keep pace and respond change the dynamics of globalization. To prepare students for globalized economy, she advocated for changes in Nigeria educational curriculum to include entrepreneurship education. To budget this, Adeyemi Sudeik and Adeba in 2018 advocated that entrepreneurial content should be incorporated into every discipline in the universities so as to shape our diverse job preference for entrepreneurial and development. And this will change the orientation for entrepreneurial activities and also facilitate the school to work transition. Globalization affects also affects teacher education and teacher retraining. It is for these reasons that the trend for teachers in training focus on school-based first-time training. I did not go around the world in 2005. This is a system of mentoring whereby teacher educators and other professionals within the schools and across the quarter of schools develop effective practices and effective practitioners. The good news is that this innovative method of training has been adopted nationwide by both UMEC and state basic education boards for teacher capacity development program. It's enhancing and transformative effect in schools and colleges in Ondo, Lagos, Ekiti, Abia, and the member states through the utilization of the role model in promoting literacy in their home states is quite outstanding and very important. Globalization, gender, and education, and for people interested, Mr. Vice Chancellor, sir, an exploration of issues that relate to the politics of education policies led me to examine how gender differences play into education policy choices and the consequences of such choices. The United Nations Education, Scientific and Cultural Organization, UNESCO, insisted that gender issues are global issues, as well as education issues. As it was in the beginning, education of women and girls remained a major challenge in developing countries. Since the World War Conference of Education for All in 1990, many countries in the regions and made demanding efforts to reduce the gender gap in access and quality of education. And that's it. The key to women empowerment is education. This is a major factor in national development and a key to poverty reduction, as well as the aspect of women, social and political sectors. And actual research by Afonja, AINO, and Adedapo in 1907 was designed in response to the general concern about the very educational status of women in Nigeria. The analysis of the research showed that at various levels, gender disparities existed in all segments of society. Where there was some development, there were more egalitarianism and better opportunities for women. Earlier in my study on women in educational leadership in 1993, it was observed that the politics of Nigerian education, since the pre-colonial era, influenced low status of Nigerian women, both in political, religious, and educational leadership. Historically, the traditional educational system, the Christian missionaries' education, the Muslims' Arabic education, were determined by the political environment, and the education system themselves operated within the national needs and policies set by the ruling classes, who were males. White females were divided. Although teaching is very highly feminized, when it comes to principalship, men tend to dominate. Whereas one of the criteria for ascending to principalship was gender based, but on the means that men should be, were women for. And in a book that I wrote in 2008, focused on the need for gender parity in higher education. This study between our non governances, that gender gap exists in higher education, and that gender participation rate is very low in science and technology, but fairly impressive in humanities. This low enrollment of females in higher education would continue to give women just a two-way representation, both in government and private sectors. Such higher education is fundamental to the construction of knowledge, and knowledge itself has become a vital factor for political education. It is also known that higher institutions are where identities are formed. Even where we have quite a number of female representation in university, this matter of political education, students in the university has shown that a significant difference exists between the political education of male and female students. I did not know an episode in 2009. Although male and female students were equally exposed to the same agency for socialization, there are more politically active male students than to the men. There are many studies by Adelabu, 1993, and from there I learned Adelabu, 1997, Adelabu, and Adelabu, 2008, Adelabu, and Adelabu, 2009. It is evident that women are less empowered educationally, socially, and politically than men. Today, the SUV and Adelabu, 2017, focus on the need to expand and renew by which policy instruments can promote equity and diversity. Judging from the fact that women and men have significant differences. The study advocated for gender mainstream as a perspective and a strategy for achieving gender equality, human development, economic growth, and poverty reduction. Towards these, it examined through the lens of gender mainstream, private and public sector activities, where men and women are not African, thereby preventing equal benefits from and toward development efforts. The study concluded that gender-based training will enable women in place, participate, and benefit from national development agenda, see also BCIM 2016. Teachers for national development, teachers are central to educational development in any country, and therefore central to national development. In this context, to avoid teachers' motivation crisis before the recommendations were made, institutionalization of annual conveyance of education stakeholders commit in Nigeria for a regular feedback and practicing on education. Radical improvement of the conditions of service of practicing teachers. Professionalization of teaching in Nigeria, which is now ongoing. Introduction of the individualized and mandatory promotion policy for school teachers. Enactment of legislation for job tenure of practicing teachers. Improved educational funding, at least to conform with international minimum standards. Adelabu 2008, Adelabu 2005, Adelabu 2003, Adelabu and Adelabu 2002. My question. Mr. Vice Chancellor, my academic and professional career witnessed rather intensive community engagement service. I have directed and coordinated more than 100 capacity development workshops, involving more than 20,000 teachers and educational practitioners in most of both the South and Eastern states of Nigeria. Through this workshop, I brought the results and fruits of my research to the doorstep of classroom teachers, who ideally should reap the fruits of professional academic research in the field of education. Sir, I have also developed fora in partnership with development partners, whose capacity of educational administrators. Through these community engagement exercises, the group of activity-based teaching has been brought to teaching and learning in most classrooms in Nigeria. Mr. Vice Chancellor, it interests you to know that quite a number of my recommendations are on technical and vocational education as a major financier for poverty reduction and national development. Today, to the glory of God, I am chairman of the National Board of Technical Education. We are both behind the areas of my report. Sir, undoubtedly there are policy gaps in major educational policies, either for lack of political will for enforcement or because of predictability of policy environment. My role as a state universal basic education body chairperson and later as deputy governor overseeing the education sector of the state gave me opportunities to bridge some of the identified gaps in the basic education sector. Remarkable among my accomplishments are introduction of Trafia, an exhibition of public technical vocational education activities as entrenched in the national policy on education. This is to facilitate public interest in technical and vocational education. Involvement of the community in education via public, private, partnership arrangements, such as the Ready Parents Program, and effective use of school-based management committee in the management of adequate-built primary school facilities. And encouragement of inclusive education by mandating that new structures in basic education was aware that government cannot do it all, particularly because of the great economy of the state and the country at large, and also because the city and the community should not be in isolation. Sir, these are many other initiatives are not only to make our school child friendly, but to reduce the nagging issue of child labor and lack of school children in the city. I was able to do this because of my background as an education. Consequently, I wish to recommend that this works, that because of the importance of basic education to education in Nigeria, any chairman to be appointed across all the states in Nigeria to have an education background, just like any other professional qualifications in the country. My contribution to scholarship is as Asian students now with all sense of immunity and the glory of God. I want to testify that I have contributed my own greater to scholarship in my department, Department of Educational Management. As a non-mentor, I coordinated the departmental activities and departmental secretary for 10 years. I was a long-time course advisor to the students at the undergraduate level. I've been able to graduate over 540 PhD students, 30 MA/MS students. I was head of department twice in 2005 and 2011. I said on department in 2011. I started the process of restructuring the department in line with the best practices to accommodate all teachers of this in the department and to the glory of God, all at the pricing GPA of accreditation. I also represented the dean and the board of faculties of law and arts. I was a founding member of the steering committee on women's community, now known as Center for Gender and Social Policy Studies. In academics, I have distributed papers in at least 5 conferences, both nationally and internationally. I was and still am an excellent veteran to a lot of universities in Nigeria. I have published 45 articles, both in national and international journals, and 4 authors published. With the cooperation of the research action team of the faculty, I was able to successfully organize an international conference in the faculty on the environment and sustainable national development. Community service. Sir, I have contributed in a number of ways on educational issues and policy making, both at the international and national activities. At the international level, I have served as consultant and national researcher, DFID UK, on State Commission of Public Services Studies, consultant and national researcher DFID UK on teacher motivation study, consultant Nigerian Constitutional Institute of Capacity Building, ICBA, Ethiopia, and the Federal Government of Nigeria. I was member of Governing Council, National Teacher Institute, Kaduna, within 2 days. At the state level, I was member of Board in the State World Bank Assisted Poverty Reduction Board 2000-2003, member in the State Education Task Force 2011, Chairman in the State Universal Basic Education Board 2011-2014, Deputy Governor in the State. Council of Christ International Divinity College and Athlete of Acadia University, Canada. I also facilitated the UNDP Osun State Medical Credit Scheme through my NGO, Center for Education and Rural Development. Sir, as I've seen, I have through these projects and activities made my modest contributions, both at international, national, state, and local level. Conclusion and recommendations. Mr. Vice Chancellor's colleagues and gentlemen from the team of my study, I've been able to look extensively into how policies and always influence education policies. I have education in terms of the first political development, not only in Nigeria, but worldwide. I've also acknowledged that most education policies have faced challenges because some of these policies were based on financial and political postulations whose predictions were also not accurate. I also focus on the paradigm dichotomy of politics and education. In my papers, however, I strongly committee members in running funding and provision of education. Nigeria was not ignored the political environment, the economic environment, the international environment as chief facilitators to educational policies and programs. These have been the first of my parents' claims and issues I made to today. Who decided to find that one person with actual materials? They defy stereotypes by changing all the course without discrimination. And according to the work of our research and education in the university, Professor Kadia, Professor Walker, Professor Batiti, Professor Max Akuma, all of them next day. I also thank you to the Dr. Ibrahim Kotu, who rendered an official support to me while writing and giving this petition. And if I tell you to Professor Walker, I'll be with you. I want to acknowledge other people who have to give materials in their time doing my research. These are Professor Esau Awokoye, who will go the first ever Universal Primary Education Report of Western African Assembly in 1952. Chief Adokanjo, former governor of the state. Chief Olaike, former governor of the state. Chief Adashi, former governor of the state. Pai Adayode, a national group of scholars. And Chief Bumirotimi, former chief inspector of education for the president. I also attended the library of the National Archives of the University of Ghana, who are having to have access to a high analytics. I also want to acknowledge the support of my colleagues in the Department of President and Pastor. The support of friends who are coming to me cannot be ignored. These are in particular Mrs. Superman of the Joe, Mrs. Okoye of the Mississippi, and Mrs. Susu and others, Mr. Pastor, families and gentlemen, very acknowledged, in particular, and the biggest gratitude, the friends of my latest family. They have given their shoulders to lean on at the critical times of my life. Their general and my name, Chief Kayos Akuyede, Dr. Stomiaki, Dr. Kayode Utiti, Dr. Akuyede Utiti, Ashiwara Jukola Chief A.A. Akuna, Professor Jujo, and Professor Jujo among others. But if this time, also especially acknowledge the distinguished Nigerian, who has assisted and sent us to the political theory of Nigeria, by giving me an appointment as a distinguished Universal Basic Education for China, and later an identity program of his administration, Dr. John Moran.
Thank you.
a husband like a father, a husband like a father, a husband who stood by me, who was tremendously supportive of my career, the father of my children, Nine, Barako, Joy, Dio, Barako, and Rupe. He is your mentor. The next friend I have, who is wanting to be praised at all times, to me, I give all the glory, honor, and adoration. Thank you for it. Who is Jesus Christ that I have so much about? His great identity, I think, that God has led me. The total agenda of this great father of learning. I thank you so much. And I continue to acknowledge and love you in death as a man. To my children, we are seeking peace from God. Grandma, this is this last day's story. Thank you all. You are my passion for life. Mr. Vice Chancellor, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to end this lecture with this song. Jesus for this, thou finding me, that thou hast left, O Lord, before us all. Jesus, my God, I thee adore, Lord, make me the only more and more. Jesus,
all right.